This is not the outcome we hoped for. It is not the outcome we prayed for, begged for, or pled for. On April 28th, Josh and Ashley and the family were here at service, and I have this picture in my mind, Josh worshiping with his family, Hannah right up next to his leg, huge smiles on both their faces. And then the very next morning, April 29th, the ground beneath us began to shift. What should have been a typical Monday morning turned upside down as we began to find out about the motorcycle accident. At the hospital, we asked God to heal him, to restore him, to fix the broken parts of his body. But God had another plan. So we come together today to worship God, who is still writing the story of Josh Burns. While he is no longer with us, he is with the God whom he loved and he served throughout his life. We come together today to celebrate Josh's life, to draw strength from one another, to be able to move day by day, moment by moment, through the grief that at times seems overwhelming. Ash, I have no idea. No idea what this is like for you, for your kids, for your families. But last night, and through this whole time, I've seen an outpouring of this community that is phenomenal. People from various churches, co-workers, friends, farming family, farming community, and God is going to use these people to strengthen you and encourage you, to help you in these days ahead. But we will all need the Lord's help. Let us pray. Dear Father, we are a group of people today who have come together, and our hearts are broken as we're experiencing the loss. We already miss Josh. We miss his infectious smile. I miss his handshake. I miss his words of encouragement. And I remember words that you spoke to your disciples, Jesus, at the point where you were going to leave them, and you said, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God, trust also in me." Our hearts are troubled right now, Lord. And we need to be able to trust in you, even in the face of not fully understanding. Your words tell us that you will bind up the brokenhearted. That's who we are. That's what we need. Be with us as we celebrate. In Jesus' name, amen.
The Lord is faithful to us every day. He's faithful to us on the good days when it seems as if the sun shines bright and life is good. God is faithful to us on the tough days when it seems as if a few things have gone wrong. God is faithful to us on devastating days like today. And God is faithful and will be faithful in the coming weeks and months and years of grief. I invite you to take your hymn book and turn to number 131. We grieve, but not as those who have no hope, for God is faithful to us. We'll sing, "Great is thy faithfulness," and let's stand together as we do so. Hymn 139.
Shadow of turning with thee. stars in their courses above. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness.
Seated. I wanted to share just a couple scriptures this morning to focus our thoughts on what the Lord has shared with us about death from His Word. The first passage of scripture is from 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. It's the verses 13 through 18, and I'm going to read it out of the Contemporary English Version. Because I think oftentimes when we read the scriptures in the same version, the words are not as stunning, as startling, as moving as when we read them fresh. The Apostle Paul writes these words. He says, "My friends, we want you to understand how it will be for those followers who have already died. Then you won't grieve over them and be like people who don't have any hope. We believe Jesus died and was raised to life. We also believe that when God brings Jesus back again, He will bring with Him all who had faith in Jesus before they died. Our Lord Jesus told us that when He comes, we won't go up to meet Him ahead of His followers who have already died. With a loud command and with the shout of the chief angel and a blast of God's trumpet, the Lord will return from heaven. Then those who had faith in Christ before they died will be raised to life. Next, all of us who are still alive will be taken up into the clouds together with them to meet the Lord in the sky. And from that time on, we will all be with the Lord forever. Encourage each other with these words." From the passage, I believe there are four ways that we are encouraged. The first of those ways is because of the resurrection of Jesus, there is resurrection of Jesus' followers. Put another way, death is not the period at the end of life for a believer. It is simply a comma. It is a pause. But life will resume, and so will it be for Josh. This is but a pause on his journey here on earth, but it will be restarted. And because Jesus walked out of his grave, Josh will as well. The second way we are encouraged is because of the return of Jesus, there is the return of Jesus' followers. If you talk to folks who have lost a close loved one, you know that the question is always, "I hope I will see them again." Relationships were not meant to end. They were meant to continue on forever. And the good news is, when Jesus returns, he brings back with him those folks who have gone ahead of us. And what is interesting is, in the scriptures, we are told that the amount of time given when Christ returns is the twinkling of an eye. Now, I don't know why some scientists decided to time it, but they have. It's 1/60th of a second. I think it reminds us that the Lord is going to allow our loved ones to come back as quickly as possible. If you know anything about mothers, when their children head off to church camp or college or back to their home living outside of town, ladies, for those of you that have children, how long do you miss your kids? Is it the first 5 minutes that they're gone, the first hour, the first day, or until you see them again? We will miss Josh until we see him again. But when the Lord begins to move, he will move as quickly as possible so that we can be reunited. Because the return of Jesus will be instantaneous, our reunion with our loved ones will also be instantaneous. He doesn't want us to have to wait one moment longer to see the person that we love. And then finally, because we will be together with Jesus forever, we will be with our loved ones forever. When I was in college and seminary, I would come back and I would spend some time with my parents on occasion. And the time would come, I would have to head out to the car to return to go back to school. And my mother, every single time, would sit there and say, "Do you really have to leave now?" "Yes, mother, I've got to go back to school." But can't you wait just a little bit long?" "No, mother, I've got to get on the road." "Are you sure?" And it was because mom didn't want me to go. At the reunion, no one has to leave again. It is the forever together. And it's promised to us in the scriptures. The second passage of scripture that I wanted to read from was John chapter 11. And to set the scene, I have to remind you that at the beginning of John 11, Jesus has been told that his good friend Lazarus is sick. It wasn't the sniffles, it wasn't a cough or a cold. He is deeply sick. And the concern on the part of the messengers is that Jesus come right away to help him. Jesus decides to wait 2 days. He tells his disciples, however, just before they leave, that when he goes, he is going to resurrect his good friend Lazarus from the dead. So picking up the story in verse 17, this is what John writes for us. On his arrival, Jesus found that Lazarus had already been in the tomb for 4 days. Now Bethany was less than 2 miles from Jerusalem, and many Jews had come to Martha and Mary to comfort them in the loss of their brother. When Martha heard that Jesus was coming, she went out to meet him, but Mary stayed at home. "Lord," Martha said to Jesus, "if you had been here, my brother would not have died. But I know that even now God will give you whatever you ask." Jesus said to her, "Your brother will rise again." And Martha answered, "I know he will rise again in the resurrection at the last day." Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and whoever lives by believing in me will never die. Do you believe this?" "Yes, Lord," she replied, "I believe that you are the Messiah, the Son of God, who is to come into the world." Jesus tells us in this passage that he changes death for his followers in two ways. The first way is, those who believe in Jesus will live even though they die. It is the promise of the resurrection. Just as Jesus walks out of his grave on Resurrection Sunday, so one day each of us will walk out of our grave at the resurrection. And then the second way that Jesus changes death, he says, whoever lives by believing in me will never die. In other words, death passes over. This fall, we will, in our country, be celebrating Halloween, and you know the picture that is given of death. It is something dark. It is something scary. It is something terrifying. Folks are afraid of death, and yet Jesus said death can never really touch the believer. It is as if you step out of your body and into the presence of the Lord, for Jesus in the scriptures tells us to be absent from the body, we are present with him. And so death does not really touch us. Skipping down a few verses, we come to the shortest verse in the English language. It's John 11:35. So short, all of you can memorize it after I read it. Jesus wept. I wondered for years, why in the world did Jesus cry in front of Lazarus' tomb when he knew just moments into the future he would resurrect his good friend Lazarus? I struggled with that for years until it dawned on me. Jesus cried to let us know it is okay for us to cry as well. God grieves at death. Death was not a part of his plan. And tears are not the absence of faith. Tears are the absence of a loved one. And how long will you cry tears? Until you see them again. It is okay to cry. It is okay to grieve. As 1 Thessalonians tells us, we grieve just not as those who have no hope. If the Son of God can grieve, so can you. And then finally, the last part of the chapter reads, Jesus, once more deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. Take away the stone, he said. But Lord, said Martha, the sister of the dead man, by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been there 4 days. Then Jesus said, did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God? So they took away the stone. And then Jesus looked up and said, Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I knew that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you sent me. And when he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. And Jesus said to them, take off the grave clothes and let him go. The two Greek words translated loud voice are megaphone. My guess is you don't need to explain to me that is where we get the term megaphone. Jesus megaphoned death. Lazarus' problem was not that he was deaf, he was dead. Jesus cries out in a loud voice, not rebuking Lazarus, but rebuking death itself. Jesus cries out, death listens, and Lazarus walks out of his tomb. Jesus one day did it, death the same day did it, and Lazarus was alive. And there is coming a day when Jesus will do it, and death will respond, and Josh will walk out of his grave. If you would, join me for a word of prayer. Father, We are grateful for the promises of Scripture. Death is not final. It is the comma, not a period. We know that Josh is experiencing the life that Jesus promised. He is more alive today, more joyous, more happy, for he is in your presence. But Father, for those of us here, the tears will be many, the time will be long, the pain will be difficult. And so, Father, we ask that you would walk with us faithfully. Help us to grieve, but with the hope of Jesus' resurrection on the back end. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Well, Josh enjoyed all things agricultural, so we'd like to take and sing a hymn. The title is In the Garden. In your hymn books, it is hymn number 635. So if you would turn there, we'll sing all three stanzas of In the Garden, but please remain seated as we do so. Hymn 635.
I come to the garden alone.
Josh's brother-in-law, Jason, is going to come and share some words with us. Jason.
Scott, thank you very much for those encouraging and hopeful words from Scripture. Before I get started, I want to, first off, as a member of the family, thank each and every one of you for coming out today, for coming out last night, and for the overwhelming wave of support over these last 2 weeks. If you brought food, if you performed yard work, if you watched or drove a child somewhere, or if you prayed for us, thank you. It has been overwhelming, and it has been necessary. want everyone to keep in mind that in many ways, today is just the beginning of our new journey. So check on us and check with each other as we move forward. My name is Jason Winchell. I'm Josh's brother-in-law. And some of you may not know me, or I may have just met you over these last couple of days. And that's not because I wasn't close with Josh. It's not because you weren't close with Josh. It's because Josh cast such a wide net. Whether you're a member of the Burns family, or the Copley community, or the community from Bob Evans, where Josh and Ashley met, if you're from Republic, if you're one of the Wayne County farmers that he's so close to, if you're from the city of Wadsworth, where he most recently worked, if you're part of the Ballman family, the Smithville Brethren Church family, the Norwayne School and Youth Sports family, or the Worcester Community Hospital family, all those people loved him and he loved them. My most recent Sunday message was purposefully on reaping what you sow. These last weeks, I've seen hundreds of people declare what Josh sowed, and here are just a few. Compassion, infectious energy, a light to so many, selflessness, genuine, family man, sense of humor, so loved, special, a jokester, contagious happiness, sweetheart, his life touched so many, goofball, left a lasting impression, authentic, whiny, and moody. Those last two were not posted, but someone important reminded me that Josh has flaws too, and we needed to mention them. Josh sowed all of these things and more. All you have to do to know this is watch him spend 5 minutes with his kids, or see how he adored Ashley, gushed over his parents, had such wonderful relationships with his sister Katie and sisters-in-law Darren and Amber, and became such close friends with his father-in-law Doug. Even his mother-in-law Diana just recently called him her favorite daughter. All those words, I believe, talk about Josh. But I have a different word as the number one word I think of when I think of Josh. It wasn't explicitly stated above, but it's within several of them. Josh was, and in many ways is, and will continue to be, an evangelizer. I know there's already been friends and family that have evangelized because of the situation that we're going through right now. I think the first day I met Josh, we talked about biblical fasting. He evangelized to everyone. It did not take long to know that Josh was a man of God, and he had an eternal mindset. Josh and Ashley yet led young groups here in this church for several years, and I know Ashley has heard from several of them during this time of how important that was. Once they started to have a family of their own, the focus changed. The focus changed to the kids and the rest of the family, but the love for the Lord never did. I have no doubt it was because of this that we were all witnesses to a heavenly fireworks show not seen here in decades last Friday night in the minutes after his passing. I've spoken a lot of hope over this talk, but that does not mean that Josh will not be missed. He will be missed deeply, and he will be missed daily. Josh's earthly legacy is alive and well. They're sitting in this first row. Ashley Burns, Eli Burns, Hannah Burns, little squeakers Leah Burns. He most assuredly has an eternal legacy as well. Built by the way he battled through his life. He battled for his soulmate. He battled for the passions in his life. And in the end, he battled at the end of his life for his family. Now we should do two things. Take comfort in each other and take comfort in Isaiah 55:9, that the Lord's ways are above our ways. And second, we should build on Josh's eternal legacy. It's our turn to battle for Burns.
Life with Josh was like he was the captain of a rubber raft heading down the rapids. And we were all along for the ride. We were hopeful, we were frightened. We had a wild time at every twist and turn. Josh was creative, up to new things. I shouldn't have been surprised, Jim, when you told me about the super soaker that was turned into a flamethrower. Josh did that with one of his friends, but I won't name them. So I don't know what it's like when you come home as a dad and your son says, "Dad, look at this." More recently, on a family vacation to Yellowstone, Josh, having experienced the beauty of the hot springs, saw a group of people near the hot springs and thought, "I'm going to jump in again." Turns out the hot spring was a cold spring, and he froze. Adventurous people don't test the waters. After Josh and Ashley got married, I observed that Josh changed jobs. The desire he had always was to better himself, to be a provider for his family, which he was super at that. He was such a hard worker. No matter what he was doing, he just worked hard all of the time. He worked in construction. One point he worked for a trash hauling company. At another point he worked at the orchard, most recently at Wadsworth. And the reality is, I frankly lost track of where Josh worked. I don't know if Ashley did, but I did. And I thought about that. I thought, okay, Josh worked at all these different places and did these different things that were all somewhat related. And Ashley graduated from nursing school, got a job at Worcester Hospital, and hasn't left. Right? When Josh had the opportunity to do something different, something he thought would be better for himself and for his family, a better fit, a better schedule, he took it. Josh was not afraid to try new things. At one point in his life, he took up the guitar, something I only found out recently. But he learned from his mother's brother-in-law, and then he had a teacher in school that had a very special guitar. And Josh had said to the teacher, "If you ever are going to sell that, I would like to buy that from you." Well, his mom got a hold of the teacher at one point and said, "Have you had thoughts of selling this?" And the teacher said, "No, I haven't. But for Josh, I will." So it's the guitar he still plays. Josh played on and off. Jim admitted that he and his daughter Katie, Josh's sister, would have liked to have cut the cord on the amplifier time and time again. But it was a great thing that he did. Come home from school and play. It was relaxing. It reduced stress. He did that in his adult life as well. He'd go down and he'd play. I found out that going to the fair, the Wayne County Fair with Josh, was quite an adventure. It used to be that everyone knew Ashley because she grew up in the community and was so connected with so many people, but after just a little while, it became hard to get through the fairgrounds without people coming up to Josh and talking to him. But a much more important part of his adventure was starting a new family with Ashley. I was reminded that they met at Bob Evans. Josh showed up to Bob Evans for pancakes and love. And he found both. Ash was a little resistant at first, but it blossomed into a wonderful relationship. And I got to watch them date and eventually get married and start their family together. And it was been a beautiful part of the adventure. After they were married, they bought their first house, which needed a roof repair. I got to see a glimpse of the community that was built around these two people. There were a number of people on that roof that day, pulling shingles, putting new shingles on, from various parts of their family and community. After that house, they moved to a trailer. After that, they moved to another house, and just like their jobs, I lost track of where they lived. I heard of an adventurous day trip to Disney. It was a one-day, do-it-all-at-once day trip that involved running from one ride to the other to the other. Ashley spoke to me about bedtime rituals with the kids. Josh reading the Bible and praying with his kids and even climbing up into the bunk bed, snuggling up. I can picture him praying with them each night as they headed to bed. Josh had many plans in his head. You all know that because he talked about them. He had dream houses that he sketched through the years. He had a dream farm that was in his mind and would remind him of the time he spent in Canada with his relatives, where the love of farming was born and grew and developed. Josh thought big, and in some ways he thought far ahead. He bought Eli his first four-wheeler when Eli was one. I can imagine Josh on the floor with his kids climbing on him. Last night at the calling hours, pictures of Josh with the kids, sleeping, napping on the couch with the kids, holding them when they were born, holding them in different times. The way in which he loved Ashley and the kids was exemplary. We all have favorite memories, pictures that we have in our mind. Mine is of that last Sunday he was with us, with Hannah right at his side. Josh, part of Josh's adventure was helping people around him. He met a variety of friends through the years. Last night, I was pleased to meet up with a few childhood friends of Josh. It says a lot about somebody when somebody travels across the country to be at a time like this, because you were friends in childhood. To have long-term friendships is something that Josh was very good at, because he loved people and he cared for people and he would do anything for them. He was always ready to, the drop of a hat, run and help somebody. I heard a story of a cow that was actively calving. He got a phone call, we need help, the cow is down by the stream. Josh took off, went down to the stream, helped the family get the cow situated, the calf was born. It cost him some time, some energy, some effort, and a boot. But that was Josh. Josh was ready to help people. He was a kind person. He was a welcoming person. If you were around him, no matter where you were, you felt welcome. Every Sunday morning, he would come in. If I was near the door, he would catch me. He would shake my hand and he would say, "How's it going?" And then we would talk. Sometimes in those talks, he would share concerns about some of you. He would share the concerns that he had about his friends and his family. Friends and his family that were struggling in one way or another, and he carried you on his heart. The way Josh treated people, how he carried himself, helped build a community of people around him. I saw it on the roof of his house all those years ago. I saw it in my own house as we began a project in our basement, and Josh said, "Hey, I want to come help do some of the framing." I said, "Oh, great." So he came over. I said, "Josh, he wants to come over on Saturday." I said, "Josh, I got my kid's soccer game. I won't be here." He said, "Just leave the house unlocked." I came back and part of the ceiling was all framed out. And another time he brought one of his friends. "Art, don't worry, go to your game. We'll hang all the interior doors for your project." But that's his friendship. Yesterday, more people gathered at the funeral home than I have ever seen in all my years of ministry. When I went to the hospital on Monday, the day of the accident, I got to the waiting room and I kind of recognized some family over here, and then all of a sudden I realized, oh no, the entire room, a large waiting room, was all there for Josh. I've never seen anything like it. Josh's greatest adventure wasn't related to his friends and the community and his work and his dream or even his family. Josh's greatest adventure began when he accepted Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. Jesus said to his disciples long ago, "Come and follow me and I will make you fishers of men." And Jesus was speaking to fishermen. And he says, "I'm going to send you out to catch people." In another place, he said, "You're going to be my witnesses in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the uttermost parts of the world. You will be my disciples and you will help people come to me." Another time, Jesus said this, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take your yoke upon me and learn from me, because I am gentle of heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." We can find rest in Jesus as we take on his yoke, as we follow him, as we live our lives for him. Josh took very seriously the words of the Bible. He learned them, he believed them, he put them into practice. And while Josh reveled in life and had great ideas and great plans about things on this earth, he also had great joy in thinking about eternity. Josh focused so much time on his work and his family and bettering things here, but it wasn't his only aim. He wanted the best, but he also knew that life was short. The Bible tells us that our lives are like a mist. They're like the fog in the morning that is there and then gone. Even people who live the longest lives, it's a short time compared to eternity. And Josh looked forward to the day, a day that is spoken about in Revelation 21 that says, "And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God is the dwelling place is now among people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eye. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain. The old order of things has passed away.'" There is a day that Josh looked forward to, that God will right every wrong, where pain and sorrow and suffering will no longer invade our lives. A day when all of the difficulties will cease. There'll be no sorrow, no cancer, no accidents. Following Jesus is just not about agreeing to a set of beliefs. It's committing your life to live for him every day and letting Jesus direct your affairs. And this is what Josh did in all of his life. Josh pledged to follow Jesus. He understood what it meant to repent, to turn away, to believe, to trust, and to follow. And it was lived out in the everyday aspects of his life. And so we want to join in the company of Josh as we gather together to honor him, to be of the people who grieve, but we grieve with hope because we believe in the resurrection of Jesus. The Bible tells us that we ought to take the comfort we receive and pass it on to others. And as I have heard some of your stories over the last several weeks, I know there are some who are here today who have walked in a very similar path to the path this family walks in today. Use the comfort you've received to comfort them as you already have. And be reminded of Psalm 23 that reminds us that God is our shepherd. And he walks with us in the best parts of life. And he walks with us through the deepest, darkest valleys. The psalm finishes with the hope of David. "Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." This was Josh's hope. This was Josh's hope, and it is ours as well. May the Lord bless us as we do the hard work of adjusting to life without our beloved Josh.
We want to give you an opportunity to sing. It is a standard, one that we absolutely love. It's hymn 343 in the hymn book. It's Amazing Grace. We're going to sing all five stanzas. And if you would, just before the last one, we're going to allow the organ to do just a little bit of a change, and then we will join in that. I would encourage you to sing it, not just as a testimony to experiencing the grace of Jesus now, but looking forward to that day when you'll stand in the presence of Christ. Let's stand together as we sing hymn 343, Amazing Grace.
Before we close the service, I want to invite you all to attend. We'll be heading to the graveside, and then we'll have a meal that's been prepared here back at the church. You're all welcome to return to the church. Or if going to the graveside is not possible for you and you want to just stay here and wait for us to come back, we will be serving the meal once the family's back. Father, we are so thankful today that you are near to us, that you are always near to us if we turn our attention to you. And so we ask for your Spirit's presence to be so clear to us in these hours. We need your hug, we need your hand, we need your presence. And we need one another as we walk through these days, Lord. Thank you for the blessing of Josh's life, for the gift that it was to us. Help us to follow his example of being a faithful follower of yours. In the strong and powerful name of Jesus, amen.